Give it, Mr. Lee, is it okay if we start in 2 minutes time?
Yes, can.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Okay, very good. Ramai orang dah masuk.
Ya, dah ada 67. That's why I'm waiting 2 minutes time. Hoping that semua dah masuk. Then we can just start lah.
Okay, saya dah enable untuk participant. So, dia boleh walk in terus lah masuk. Tak ada waiting room lagi.
Alright, thanks Joe. Selamat tengah hari, everyone. Hoping that everyone is staying safe, ya. Everyone can use the chat box to identify yourself, ya. Chat box tu for questions pun boleh. To chat with everyone pun okay. If you ada questions, kalau you takut benda tu orang tak nampak, you can message me personally or you can message it straight to Dr. Hafizah. Oh, we are also live on Facebook, if I'm not mistaken. Joe, are we live on Facebook?
Yes, yes.
We are live on Facebook. So, we are also live on Facebook. If you have friends yang tak sempat nak register for today, you can search us on Facebook.
Okay lah, Mira.
Alright, I think we're starting now. Greetings to everyone, especially Dr. Hafizah binti Hassan, our speaker today. Our MWA President, Dr. Haji Ash'ari Muhammad, and all participants, welcome to MWA Masterclass Series 4, Better Safe Than Sorry, Drinking Water Quality Management from Catchment to Consumers. Just a little housekeeping before we start with today's presentation. Participants can use the chat box to say hello to friends and colleagues participating in the webinar. For question and answers, please use the chat box also, as I mentioned earlier. You can direct message me if you, in case we miss your questions here or Dr. Hafizah, and we will try to answer, Dr. Hafizah will try to answer your questions after the presentation, yeah? We will also email the presentation slides to participants after the webinar for today. And I think that's all. Now I would like to invite Dr. Haji Ash'ari Muhammad to give some welcoming remarks. I already asked. Okay, I think
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good afternoon. Apa khabar semua? I hope everyone is fine on the first week of the so-called lockdown. I think with the lockdown, we have more time probably to do things that we cannot do when we have to drive an hour or two every day to work. So today and now onwards, we are going to have more time probably to do things that we cannot do before. So as of today, I would like to welcome all of you to this fourth series of the MWA webinar on masterclass lecture. So terima kasih Amira for giving me this opportunity to address the others. I think we have more than 70 viewers here, and I would like to wish all of you welcome to this MWA webinar masterclass series. And of course, besides familiar names, there are also new faces. Of course, as we have the conventional seminar conference, we used to meet face to face. And of course, I took the opportunity just now to glance through the viewers. Of course, some of them are familiar faces and some are new faces. So to everyone, I wish welcome. And of course, today we shall be very fortunate to listen from our expert, local experts, Dr. Hafiza Hassan. She's from the Ministry of Health, the famous engineering division, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. We used to work with engineering division since 1980s, very closely in water sector. I think the engineering division of Ministry of Health has been very close to the water fraternity, and MWA really appreciate that this relationship continues. And today we are fortunate to have Dr. Hafiza. We'll be talking about something that is concerning our life and death. Better safe than sorry. Water quality, drinking water quality management from catchment to consumers. I think it's a very wide topic, and I hope she'll be able to actually manage the time, because being expert and given a wide topic will be a big challenge for Dr. Hafiza to speak within the stipulated time. So of course, this is not the first series, and it's probably, I was told, this is the fourth series of this masterclass lecture on webinar. And of course, the support that we are getting from the industry is very encouraging, and I really, on behalf of the Malaysian Water Association, really very grateful and thank all of you for being very supportive. I hope this webinar will be an interactive one. I think as we have more and more webinars, I think we are able to communicate better, so that both parties will be able to share experience and knowledge. So I think with this lecture today, we'll be probably listening about more about how actually water quality, especially drinking water quality, is managed in this country. And of course, water safety plan will be one of the important area that Dr. Hafiza will be touching. I think she wrote a lot about water safety plan, from the planning until the implementation. I think she's very familiar with water safety plan. I think we like to listen on that and share with everyone here on the aspect of water quality management. And as far as we are concerned, of course, there is some gap in what we intended and what is on the ground. I think, of course, we have given very big hope to actually our fellow brothers and sisters in the SPAN. But I think with SPAN and MOH both getting together and working closely, I think this would be bigger success. I say this because in SPAN there are provisions in the law about water safety plans. But all this while, I think water safety plan has been actually the forte of Ministry of Health. I think we need to synergize both institutions so that we could actually reach a better height in terms of achieving water safety plan. In my own observation, which I shared with a few we call it players in the water resources fraternity. Water safety plan is actually part of the integrated water resources management. I think this is the aspect that is still also need to be enhanced, where water safety plan work together with integrated water resources management, because what integrated water resources management more of things at the policy level, whereas water safety plan, of course, is policy as well, but a lot of things happening on the ground. So there are actually a mix of many things in this water industry. And I think by bringing Dr. Hafizah here and with the, support from the industry, I think we have nearly 80 now. And we like this to be later shared with others. So we hope that water safety plan will be a big success for the management of drinking water in the country. So finally, I would like to thank Dr. Hafizah for spending her time. I think a very valuable time that she has to sacrifice for us in Malaysian Water Association. And of course, all of you, the viewers, kawan-kawan semua, water sector, I think we would like to have to meet each other face-to-face, but it may take some time before we could do that. So with that, thank you very much, Amira. I would like to pass the floor to you. And thank you very much, everyone, for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Dr. Sari Mamat. Okay, thank you so much for the opening remarks. And now, a very short introduction for our speaker today, just additional of what Dr. Jasari already said just now. Dr. Hafizah Hassan is the Senior Principal Assistant Director with the Engineering Service Division, Ministry of Health, MOH Malaysia in Putrajaya. Trained as a public health engineer herself, Dr. Hafizah has a broad understanding and experience in the field of drinking water quality surveillance and water management. Her contributions towards drinking water quality surveillance in Malaysia is endless. And Dr. Hafizah is a member of WHO International Network of Drinking Water Regulators. She is an individual member of the International Solid Waste Association, ISWA, since 2008, as well as the International Water Association, IWA, since 2013. With her background, I'm pretty sure she, Dr. Hafizah, have a lot to share today. Without further ado, I pass the screen to Dr. Hafizah. I think you're on mute still. All right. Okay, thanks.
Okay, terima kasih kepada Amira and also kepada organizer. MWE. Assalamualaikum and a very good afternoon. Okay, as been said, the slides are a lot, tremendous, trying to look into many aspects of drinking water quality management. Some would say management, some would say governance, so that would be different topic to speak about. Anyway, so this is me as a presenter related to this topic. I'm actually a WHO water safety plan trainer since 2011 with PUB Singapore at the time, under David Sutherland, the WHO consultant, and the rest Amira has mentioned just now. And I think one part that I would like to address is actually on the latest journal article that have been published by this year, actually, that is related to us, water safety plans. So I did a case study for Malaysia and also for England and Wales. So we can have a look in more details in the journal article. I provide the link as well. And okay, this is actually the target participants. Generally, yang dah ada understanding of the water safety plan process and methodology. So this is not a WSP introduction. Okay. Second is those directly develop, implement and maintain water safety plans. And then those yang actually directly involved dengan drinking water quality monitoring and surveillance. So a wide range of water sector here, water industry, and then regulators, policy makers, universities, research institutes, perhaps, you know, and then I hope this webinar will benefit these people. Okay. And so during this lecture, I would like to capture on the historical perspective, overview of concepts and principles, mostly on the risk assessment principles that has been captured for water safety plans. And second, on the drinking water quality management scenario in Malaysia. Yang ni sentuh sikit-sikit je. Sebab mostly saya rasa ramai yang dah tahu. Thirdly, on the health-based targets. Pun sikit-sikit je. Fourth, water safety plans. Kelima, on drinking water quality surveillance. Dan enam, yang ni saya rasa kena cerita banyak sikit lah. Country experience and case examples. Okay, so my expectation at the end of the lecture, satunya, at least ada understanding of the risk-based concepts and principles for drinking water quality. Second one is apa ni, the wide spectrum of risk assessment and risk management for drinking water quality and what we are going to use actually dekat Malaysia ni lah. Yang kita nampak satu je, water safety plan. Konsep dia sama, but then approach-nya berbeza di tempat yang berbeza, di apa ni, dalam konteks yang berbeza. Saya akan tunjukkan apa ni, a few. And then thirdly, risk-based approach in drinking water quality surveillance. Okay, so yang ni ada beza between compliance-based and risk-based approach. Yang sekarang yang kita amalkan ialah compliance-based. We are not really at risk-based approach as yet. So we need to know this too. And then yang keempat, get exposed with the country experience and case examples. Okay. All right. So this webinar, satunya it will be practical. Okay, ada teori dan ada examples and few activities. Might be limited lah sebab kita buat webinar, but we try. Okay. And then participatory. Okay, ada engagement with some activities, you know. And then as I mentioned earlier, it's very intensive, a lot of material. Tapi saya akan cuba skip mana-mana yang apa ni, yang yang rasa macam ni saya akan skip. Yang mana yang ni saya akan cuba terangkan dengan detail lah. Okay. So okay. First, setting the scene. Okay. Satu in terms of historical perspective. Okay. Yang ni apa ni, in terms of the beginning of apa ni, macam mana kita try to get the awareness from for drinking water safety. Dr. John Snow, the keyword is Dr. John Snow, 1854, Broad Street cholera outbreak. Yang ni ceritanya daripada tahun 1854 di London, di Broad Street London, sampai tahun 1958 WHO mengeluarkan International Standards for Drinking Water. Fokusnya pada masa ni ialah microbial pathogens like E. coli, tuberculosis, bacteria, mostly bacteria, protozoa, a little bit of protozoa. And then since 1970 sampai 1990 ni, mostly lebih kepada anthropogenic chemicals. Chemicals originating from human activities. Yang mainly environmentally pollutions and pollutants, you know. So this actually related to the parameters in the standards. So daripada tahun 1958 ni, okay, WHO start publish international standards for drinking water. And then dia dalam tahun 1984 dia tukar nama kepada WHO guidelines for drinking water quality. That was the first edition, 1984. Okay, and daripada awal tahun 1970-an 70 ni, yang ni bawah apa ni, European standards for drinking water, sampai tahun 1990-an fokusnya on anthropogenic chemical. So banyak masa ni sangat dynamic. Even the WHO guidelines for drinking water quality pun terbit dua edition at this time to capture that. And masa ni memang dynamic with end product testing. Dan juga compliance dengan standards. Yang biru ni, WHO Surveillance of Drinking Water Quality. This is actually a monograph published by WHO mentioning about how to undertake a surveillance program in at the country level and subnational and ground level, you know. So there are steps including masa ni sanitary surveys was introduced in this monograph, in this 1976 monograph. Okay, dekat Malaysia kita ada buat sanitary survey kan, kajian kebersihan. So yang ni first dia diperkenalkan. And then since 1994 ada satu artikel by Havelaar on HACCP, application of HACCP to drinking water supply. HACCP ni actually dah lama dah, since 1960s, meant for food for NASA space flights. Okay, but then in 1994 baru dia introduce for drinking water supply. So more on the critical control points based on HACCP approach. And then in 2004, that's actually the start for water safety plans, WHO guidelines for drinking water quality, third edition. In these guidelines, the water safety plans been introduced. And at the same time, through the IWA Bond Charter, the advocate lah, water safety plans that have been published through the WHO guidelines in 2004. So within this period, 1994-2004, 10 years, that there was actually increasing awareness of hazard, okay? Keyword the hazard daripada natural chemicals. Walaupun there was also an emphasis on microbial pathogens. Okay, so this is actually the setting when we talk about global wash water sanitation and hygiene. Okay, yang ni bawah bawah UN, United Nations, and then diterbitkan melalui aktiviti-aktiviti di bawah agensinya dalam konteks ni WHO, UNICEF. Okay, alright. So from 2000 sampai 2030, is actually within the context of Sustainable Development Agenda. Okay, so 2000 to 2015 Millennium Development Goals. Okay, masa ni dia bercerita tentang wash, tapi without hygiene, just for water and sanitation. So this is actually the goal for the Millennium Development Goals at that time. Okay, goal ni untuk capai akses kepada safe drinking water and basic sanitation. Target ni dicapai pada tahun 2010. Tetapi kenapa masih diteruskan di dalam Sustainable Development Goals 2015-2030? Kerana satu, tak ada elemen hygiene, dan satu lagi dicapai pada tahun 2010 tetapi tidak menyeluruh kepada semua konteks geografi. Contohnya kalau kita lihat dokumen WHO and UNICEF through the laporan Joint Monitoring Program JMP, laporan tu dia lebih kepada sustainable access di kawasan bandar, di kawasan luar bandar, limited resources area, yang tu memang kurang. Dan lagi satu, ada perbezaan di antara orang kaya, orang miskin, more affluent community, especially di negara-negara maju, dia capai tetapi tidak di negara-negara yang ke belakang lah. Okay, so that's why that's actually antara sebab kenapa isu dalam konteks wash, water, sanitation and hygiene diteruskan lagi di dalam Sustainable Development Goals. Okay, selama 15 tahun. So there are targets untuk water, sanitation and hygiene. Did they support di dalam goal 6 ni, target 6.1 by 2030 achieve. Saya highlight di sini universal menyeluruh and equitable. Maksudnya tak kira. Semua dapat access to safe and affordable drinking water for all. Okay. And also target 6.2 ni for sanitation and hygiene for all. Okay. Kita tak nampak di Malaysia yang kita tak nampak, tetapi di negara lain, contohnya di negara yang yang sukar untuk mendapatkan fasiliti bekalan air ataupun fasiliti sanitasi dan hygiene, mereka tak ada privilege macam kita. Air nak kena berjalan 10 kilometer nak dapatkan air, dan pada masa yang sama ada diskriminasi in terms of bila dia kena pergi ambil air. Budak-budak ni contohnya, especially perempuan, dia tak boleh pergi sekolah. So kita tak nampak senario tu di Malaysia, but they are. Because now we are talking about global wash, okay? So we have to admit that they are still. Okay, so when we talk about goal three by our SDGs is actually about achieving universal health coverage. So dalam konteks wash, water supply termasuk di dalam konteks ni, dan dinyatakan di dalam dokumen WASH in Healthcare Facilities di bawah WHO dan UNICEF Joint Monitoring Program. So dalam konteks untuk healthcare facilities, WASH ni diterjemahkan kepada 5 provisions yang saya nyatakan di sini tahun 2019 dia keluarkan statement ni. Okay, satu, water, sanitation, hygiene of course, and then ada 2 pertambahan iaitu waste management and environmental cleaning. So yang ni untuk healthcare facilities, but after all water still ada. So meaning to say yang ni untuk institutions, institutionally dinyatakan untuk healthcare facilities. That's actually a significant significant need for that water. Of course, it's actually under the UN resolution as well, the human right to water and sanitation since 2010. Satu, dia kata safe, selamat, affordable, acceptable, accessible and sufficient water and sanitation services to all. So dalam konteks untuk air ni, dia bukan setakat kita nampak quality dan quantity. It's very straightforward, right? But of course, we have to see it beyond that. Selamat, affordable, acceptable, accessible, and sufficient. So this is actually, these are actually the keywords that we need to stick to. Instead of having in mind that okay, drinking water quality, you nampak quality aja, or you nampak quantity aja. No, it's not. It's actually more than that, because setiap satu ni dia akan memberi impact kepada keselamatan air minum, contoh. So we have to bear in mind that okay, because that's actually been declared through the human right to water and sanitation and has been addressed in MDGs as well as SDGs. Sekarang ni bawa SDGs, so we need to embrace that towards the Sustainable Development Agenda 2030. Okay. So ini yang saya nyatakan tadi, daripada MDGs to SDGs. Okay, the JNP Joint Monitoring Program, so, this actually yang dipanggil sebagai service ladders. Yang sebelah kiri sekali ialah untuk water, ada definition untuk apa ni, improve and also for surface water. That's actually the definition yang ada ni dalam MDG. But then definition ini juga di bawah service ladder untuk air ni masih juga digunapakai di dalam SDG. SDG dia walaupun diguna terminologi safely managed, basic, limited, unimproved surface water, but then dia punya definition ni masih terpakai. So once we talk about water safety plans, when they mentioned about safely managed, so we understand, oh, what actually the meaning of safely managed, for example, what actually the basic, limited, improved for surface water. Just safely managed here, it means that ada pipe air dekat rumah, okay, dekat sini pipe household water connection located inside the user's dwelling ataupun dalam kawasan rumah lah, contoh. Okay, yang lain ni nanti mungkin apa ni, tuan-tuan dan perempuan boleh baca lah. It's actually the what you have to know, the definition and also the terminology that been used. Because this definition and terminology akan tuan-tuan dan perempuan akan nampak dan akan lihat sepanjang tuan-tuan dan puan-puan melaksanakan Water City Plans. Bear in mind, Water City Plans is not a stand-alone activity. It's very integrated and very comprehensive. So just bear in mind on the terminology. Okay, so yang ini pula, wash in healthcare facilities. Okay, ada element water di sini. Okay, ini dia punya service ladder lah. Makna kata kalau lebih ke tingkat atas tu, makna kata dia safely managed lah. Okay, so yang ni actually within the context of monitoring yang dilaksanakan oleh WHO dan UNICEF. So sebelum ni, every year since 1990, UNICEF, WHO dan UNICEF through joint monitoring program, dia keluarkan report every year, report. So within MDGs ada report, ada dimasukkan di situ country report untuk Malaysia dan negara-negara lain lah. So kalau tuan-tuan dan perempuan cari dalam internet, memang ada, nak boleh baca lanjut tentang service ladder. Dan yang ini pula untuk healthcare facilities diperkenalkan pada tahun 2019. Konsep dia sama, cuma konteksnya berbeza. Di healthcare facilities. Okay. Alright, ini untuk drinking water quality dalam konteks global wash. Dalam konteks global wash untuk drinking water quality, saya ada sebut tadi compliance based and risk based. Okay, kalau tuan-tuan dan puan-puan lihat kat bawah ni, okay, compliance based approach and product testing. Okay, nanti saya akan cerita sikit. And I think most of you might know it already, tapi saya cerita jugalah sikit. Lepas tu risk based approach. So cutting point dia tahun 2004. Masa publication of guidelines for drinking water quality. Di dalam ni, seperti mana yang saya sebut, dinyatakan berkaitan dengan water safety plans. Dan sebelum itu, okay, monograph, 1976 WHO monograph on surveillance of drinking water quality, disebut juga berkenaan dengan kajian kebersihan. Okay. So compliance based approach ni it's not that kita akan once we do risk based approach, it doesn't mean that we have to ignore this part. Compliance based approach is more on penambahbaikan. Maksudnya dalam konteks risk based approach, compliance based ni ada dalam risk based approach ni. Jadi saya cerita. Okay, so tadi saya dah cerita kata apa ni, guidelines for drinking water quality WHO advocate what is the plans in 2004, and then in 2009 diterbitkan pula water safety plan manual. So manual ni dia actually design, the methodology was designed for urban water supplies. So untuk urban water supplies, dalam konteks modulnya memang lengkap lah, 1 sampai 11 dalam ni. Okay, so kalau kita nak lihat dalam konteks WSP, dalam konteks rural water supplies, community manage ke kan, ataupun loji air yang kecil-kecil kan, sebab kita kat Malaysia kan banyak kan loji air yang kecil-kecil, yang remote kan, yang tu takkan nak pakai yang ini, yang water safety plan manual ni kan, sebab dia complete kan. So we need to consider for simplified water safety plans. Okay, yang tu pun ada dalam ni. WHO pun ada keluarkan kaedah macam mana nak buat. Dan pada masa yang sama, WHO juga keluarkan few publications on institutional water safety plans. So on institutional water safety plans, 2011 contohnya, water safety in buildings. And then ada apa lagi? Banyak ni, rata-rata. Ada untuk aviation, untuk ships, cruise kan. And then ada juga untuk of course more communities and what not. But then okay, melalui satu assembly, just nak bagi tahu, in 2011 ni ada assembly, World Health Assembly, yang dianggotai oleh semua member states lah, including Malaysia. Masa ni diorang dah declare drinking water sanitation and health yang berkaitan dengan water safety plans. So ni punca kuasa lah, kalau orang government ni kan suka sebut punca kuasa kan, punca kuasa. So punca kuasa untuk negara-negara di bawah WHO ialah ini, World Health Assembly Drinking Water Sanitation and Health, number ni 62.24, yang berkaitan dengan water safety plans. Among others, dia ada sebut to work to strengthen as necessary the establishment, implementation and quality control of water safety plans. Okay, yang ni maksudnya untuk member states lah. Member states to strengthen the intersectoral policy frameworks and institutional mechanisms for integrated management of water and sanitation related health hazards and risks. So ini satu yang dipegang untuk water safety plans. Okay, and of course water safety plans ni dia also capture for other elements of sustainable development goals, contohnya in terms of climate resilient, and then in terms of equity. Yang ni yang saya sebut awal tadi kan, perbezaan antara orang kaya, orang miskin, orang luar bandar, orang bandar kan. Itu dia terbitkan lah few guidance on this. And also sanitation safety plan, Yang ni pun ada juga sebab apa ni berkaitan dengan apa ni water safety plans. Memang berkaitan, cuma dalam konteks sedation lah. Okay. What else? Oh yeah, dalam tahun 2019 juga, yang ni tahun 2011 pasal water safety plans in general, right? But in 2019, at the World Health Assembly 72.7 wash in healthcare facilities. Dalam ni pun ada disebut tentang water safety plans. Okay, ni another punca kuasa lah I would say. Okay, and then last year WHO ada publish a new package, packages actually untuk drinking water for sanitary inspection. Okay, so dalam konteks risk-based approach ni, okay, bear in mind there are three terminologies that you should know. Satu, yang whole complete water safety plans. Okay, yang satu lagi simplified water safety plans. And the third one sanitary inspection. Bukan sanitary survey, sanitary inspection. Okay, sanitary survey duduk kat sini. Dalam monograph ni, surveillance of drinking water quality. Okay, tapi yang ni jugalah yang di, apa ni orang kata improvise. Jadi water safety plans, jadi simplified water safety plans, jadi sanitary inspection. Bukan saya kata, WHO kata. Okay, so yang ni semua dimasukkan juga di dalam WASH Strategy 2018-2025. Okay, antaranya dia ada sebut delivering and supporting uptake of WASH guidance including water safety plans and sanitation safety planning. Okay. So ni dalam konteks drinking water quality at the global context ya, dalam WASH context. Okay, so yang ni pula dalam konteks WASH dekat Malaysia. Okay, memandangkan saya orang kesihatan, saya akan cerita jugalah sikit-sikit kan pasal apa ni orang kata WASH in Malaysia related to drinking water quality. Satu yang saya paling ingat berkaitan dengan pelaksanaan program Bakas in 1973. Saya tak ada lagi macam ni, tapi that was been told the MOH initiated Rural Environmental Sanitation Program Bakas, program Bakas in this year. And then this is actually this was under Rancangan Malaysia Kedua. Okay, to bridge the gap between the urban and the rural communities, you know, in terms of the water and sanitation amenities. And then in 1983, MOH initiated KEMAM, Kawalan Mutu Air Minum Program, Program KEMAM, National Drinking Water Quality Surveillance Program. This actually being piloted together with Cawangan Bekalan Air JKR and also Jabatan Kimia Malaysia. That was actually the earliest collaboration involved. I still remember when I was started joining MOH, I have to go meetings with CBA dekat JKR HQ dulu. So yeah, that was the time. And I think that's actually the collaboration, the multi-agency, the first multi-agency collaboration that we had with JKR and Jabatan Kimia. And then in 1986, that was actually the full blow of the program throughout the country, Sabah, Sarawak included. And that was been sparked by this incident in 1982, I've been told. There was acute gastroenteritis outbreaks in Seremban due to improper sanitation, sewage being thrown upstream of one main river in Seremban, upstream the water intake point. So that was the first incident that sparked the implementation of KEMAM program. And then in 1993, MOH started with QAP, Quality Assurance Program. And 1994, they started to think about safe drinking water bill. And then due to certification apa ni, ISO lah apa semua, major, some of the major utilities started to undertake that in 2003. And then 2005, Malaysian water sector reform with the Water Industry Services Act 2006, Act 655 in 2006. This actually meant for Semenanjung Malaysia and Labuan, excluded Sabah and Sarawak. Also with the formation of SPAN, Suruhanjaya Perkhidmatan Air Negara, untuk kawasan as an economic and technical regulator, I would say. And then 2009, kita tahu kan, 2004, WSP been introduced by WHO and been supported by IWA. But 2009 in Malaysia, the introduction of rural water safety plans with the pilot projects in 2010. In 2011, that was the time for the introduction of urban water safety plans, also with the inclusion of mandatory water safety plans in the Safe Drinking Water Bill. And at the same time, the urban water safety plan pilot projects. Okay. Dan pada tahun yang sama, memang tahun 2011 ni kira memang apa ni, giat sungguh lah. Apa ni, sebab Rural Water Safety Plans handbook pun keluar waktu ni, and also the WSP format guidance and examples untuk urban water supplies and all the workshops and what not lah, at that time 2011-2012. I was there, so I know. 2014, rural water safety plan scale up and auditing, as well as for urban water safety plan. And then 2016, drinking water quality index been introduced. Okay. And then 2019, wash in healthcare facilities. And of course, with the inclusion in the Rancangan Malaysia. Okay. So that's actually the scenario for drinking water quality context within WASH in Malaysia. Okay, so ini, when we talk about risk-based approach, Stockholm framework. Okay, Stockholm framework has been introduced through this document by Futrell and Bertram. Water quality, guideline standards and health assessment of risk and risk management for water-related infectious diseases. Ini adalah prinsip asas yang digunapakai oleh mana-mana dokumen WHO yang berkaitan dengan risk-based approach. Okay, tak kira lah air minum ke, sanitation ke, rekreasi ke, semua pakai konsep yang sama, Stockholm Framework. So daripada Stockholm Framework ni, okay, dalam konteks air minum, diterbitkan Framework for Safe Drinking Water, this one. So there are three pillars, three important pillars: health-based targets, water safety plan, independent surveillance. So kalau bercerita pasal water safety plan, berkaitan dengan health-based targets and surveillance as well. Dia tak boleh bercakap water safety plan sahaja. Kalau cakap pasal water safety plan sahaja, saya boleh bercakap in terms of the full apa ni, module of water safety plans that I mentioned earlier. The simplified water safety plans and the sanitary inspection. Tiga tu aja. Tapi macam mana pun, within the modules and steps, health-based targets and independent surveillance termasuk. So kena cerita. Okay. So dalam konteks framework for safe drinking water, health-based targets ni bahasa mudahnya I would say standards lah. Standard quality air minum. Paling mudah lah nak faham. Okay. And then water safety plan, of course this is the definition yang ada di dalam guidelines WHO. Comprehensive risk assessment and risk management approach that encompasses all steps in the drinking water supply from catchment to consumer. Okay, which supports water suppliers with effective management to ensure the safety of the supply system. Okay, so independent surveillance. So this one, Okay, yang ni apa ni? Periodic review external from the water supplier of all aspects of drinking water quality and public health safety, including providing confirmation that water safety plans are effective and the health-based targets are met. So dalam konteks WSPs are effective, okay, yang ni dalam ada apa ni orang kata ada kaitan dengan operational monitoring dan juga verification. Okay, itu that's actually the modules involved, but nanti saya ceritalah. Okay, saya balik kepada slide yang awal. Lebih. Okay, yang ini. From compliance to risk-based approach. Okay, so dalam konteks compliance-based approach, kita ada sampling, right? So yang ni kita bercerita tentang microbial parameters. That's actually the most crucial lah, I would say, among others. Of course yang lain pun ada juga lah kan, but yang ni yang ni sebab dia punya impact dia acute. Tiba-tiba dia tak macam chemical parameters ambil masa bertahun kan. Yang ni kalau sekali ni memang ni, sebab tu dalam standard dia punya standard ni guidance value dia kosong. Tak ada kompromi, kena kosong, especially untuk E. coli dan total coliform, kosong. Kosong MPN per 100 ml ke kan. Patutnya tak ada. So bila kita bercerita dalam konteks air minum, too little too late, maksudnya too little bila kita buat sampling kat sampling station, right? Pipe air tu besar. Air banyak. Tapi kita ambil sampel tu representative sikit, betul tak? But then pada masa yang sama, kalau kata ada kuman dalam air tu, kuman tu dia bukannya duduk apa ni orang kata well distributed dalam pipe air tu, dia bersepah sekur kat sana, sekur kat sini, merata-rata kan. So bila kita ambil air pada at that time, air tu pula bergerak, dia bukan duduk statik di situ. Air tu kita ambil masa tu, dan bila kita nak buat resampling, kita tak boleh nak ambil sampel yang sama sebab it's dynamic. So by the time contamination is identified, water has been consumed. So it's been too late and waterborne illness occurs, you know. Contohlah waterborne illness ni like macam tadi saya dah sebut, acute gastroenteritis, dysentery, typhoid, cholera, so a few. Okay. So dalam konteks ni kita lihat outbreaks ni dia tak ada reliance dengan drinking water indicators, in the sense that drinking water indicators ni kalau berlaku kalau berlaku outbreak even di negara-negara maju yang ada melaksanakan risk assessment dengan sebut water safety plan kan, risk assessment, walaupun dia ada buat drinking water indicators, masih berlaku lagi outbreak. So no so reliance on drinking water indicators, it means that there are many other things that need to be considered, you know. That's why tak sepatutnya hanya bergantung kepada compliance based ni, maksudnya certain value masa kita dapat water sample tu kita bandingkan dengan guidelines value. Kan, contohnya kalau kata macam E. coli patut kosong tapi nampak ada satu. So melanggarlah. So compliance based ni maksudnya kalau you dengar perkataan melanggar, pelanggaran, violation, that's compliance. Kalau untuk risk based approach, dia lebih kepada bila you communicate you dengan perkataan hazards, risk, yang tu yes. That's actually risk based approach. Kalau ada melanggar, pelanggaran, violation, yang tu compliance based. Memang compliance. Okay. So that's why we need risk-based approach, because risk-based approach ni kita anticipate based on hazards, based on hazardous events, based on risk assessment, you know. And then it's not just focusing on compliance-based. Compliance-based ni, yes, we need that in risk-based approach. Tapi dalam konteks operational monitoring, contohnya. Dan juga dalam konteks verification. Dalam konteks operational monitoring, we need compliance to make sure that the control measure is effective enough. Okay, and for verification purposes, kita perlukan compliance base because we want to know, we want to ensure that the water safety plan is effective. Okay, satu control measure, satu water safety plan. You see, so you have to understand where it stands. Okay, so that's been shift of thinking from compliance to risk based dalam framework for safe drinking water yang saya tunjuk tadi, and this has been spelled out in the guidelines for drinking water quality. Okay, right, and within this dinyatakan, okay, untuk health-based targets ni, in one of WHO documents, health-based targets ni by apa ni? Competent health authority. Okay, kalau competent health authority ni, apa ni? Kalau kat Malaysia ni, MOH lah yang patut set up the standard. Okay, water safety plan, of course, water operators. Yang ni memang apa ni orang kata supposed to be implemented by water safety by water operators, mana-mana pun, bukan kat Malaysia je, dekat tempat lain pun sama. Independent surveillance, it depends on the institutional and the apa ni regulatory framework of the country, and mostly memang di bawah Kementerian Kesihatan di negara masing-masing lah. Although kalau macam dekat UK tu dia tak panggil Kementerian Kesihatan lah, dia panggil Drinking Water Inspectorate contohnya. Okay, so that's apa ni, the agency involved. Sebab kalau macam dekat UK ada SPAN, ada juga agensi lain yang berperanan seperti SPAN, kita panggil Ofwat. So yang tu dalam konteks yang berbeza, but supporting and complementing each other, you know. Dia apa ni, they try to compete each other. Kalau sempat saya cerita, kalau tak sempat mungkin lain kali lah. But then okay, so yang ni pula Bond Charter bawah IWA yang apa ni, yang memang advocate water safety plan lah. Okay, dalam konteks ni, ini yang dinyatakan daripada catchment to consumers. Okay, and then this is actually the roles and responsibilities of water operators, water utilities, and this is actually the goal. Goal ni memang tersemat lah di mana-mana, especially the water utilities. When I was in the UK, I went to few of the utilities. Yang inilah dia punya ni, dia pegang ni, good safe drinking, which that has trust of consumers. And of course, in the UK, they have been talking about wholesome drinking water. That's certainly another topic that we can discuss about. Okay. So drinking water quality management scenario in Malaysia, tadi pun saya dah sebut sikit-sikit. Yang ni mostly pun dah tahu. Management and to the tap, macam-macam lah kita kat Malaysia ni, urbanization lah, deforestation lah, kat catchment pun semua ni kan, industrialization lah, and then new township lah, and then kadang kita pun tak tahu, kadang loji ada dulu, loji air kan contohnya, tapi pembangunan datang kemudian, so how we want to address that. So macam-macam lah. So dalam konteks ni, untuk pemantauan kualiti air minum di bawah Kementerian Kesihatan Malaysia, of course kita ada apa ni, few terminologi yang pakai lah untuk dekat apa ni, waktu kita buat sampling, SRO, TPO kan, distribution notification. So very straightforward. So yang ni pula demarcation of apa ni orang kata drinking water quality management in Malaysia before the amendment of the federal constitution in 2005 so that kita boleh apa ni orang kata apa ni gubal akta apa ni industri air kan. Sebelum ni semua dalam kuasa bidang kuasa negeri lah. Daripada punca sampai distribution. Yang ni ceritanya sebelum meter lah. Okay, semua kuasa di bawah state lah. But then after the amendment of the federal constitution, sebab di dalam federal constitution dia ada jadual satu, jadual dua, jadual bersama. So sebelum ni memang di bawah jadual bawah state sajalah. But then after the amendment, cuma kuasa state cuma untuk apa ni, air mentah sajalah, water resources. And federal handled treatment and distribution. Okay. Tapi di bawah, yang ni untuk semua, untuk semua. Cuma di bawah apa ni, Akta Industri Air, bidang kuasa cuma tertakluk di Semenanjung Malaysia dan juga the Federal Territories. So mean to say, Sabah dan Sarawak masih tertakluk di bawah enactment dan ordinance masing-masing. Okay. So yang ni lah kita punya ni, memang kita ada banyak hierarki. Kita ada federal government, ada state government. Lepas tu kita ada apa ni, dekat state pun kita ada local authorities lah. Kita ada ni, and then kita punya water utilities pun macam-macam. Ada yang corporatized, ada yang private, ada yang public public works department pun ada lagi satu. Lepas tu water boards, macam-macam. So kita punya ni memang quite complicated sikit lah, but then apa ni, that makes us unique. Okay, so ni yang saya cerita tadi, health based targets ni apa ni, bahasa mudahnya guidelines yang ada di dalam apa ni, guidelines yang kita guna pakailah. So kalau kat Malaysia ni, guidelines kita garis panduan kualiti air minum yang diterbitkan oleh WHO pada tahun 2000, tetapi telah di apa ni review pada tahun 2004 dan dimasukkan di dalam manual kawalan untuk air minum. Dan apa ni, saya rasa sekarang pun apa ni dalam progress untuk review kot kan, sebab WHO pun since 2004 dia dah keluar dua kali edition kan, 2011 and then 2017. This is the latest one, the guidelines for drinking water quality yang been published by WHO. Dan pada masa yang sama WHO dah terbitkan in 2008 macam mana kita nak develop drinking water quality regulation and standards, especially di negara-negara with limited resources. So yang tu pun kita boleh guna to make a do with our own local flavor guidelines lah. Okay, ni yang saya sebut tadi. And then water safety plans. Okay, yang ni kita biasa nampak lah. Media bedak kan, krisis air lah, lepas tu pasal tarif air, pasal air kotor lah, lepas tu ada ni kes, ada insiden macam ni, lepas tu bila raya tak ada air, lepas tu ini air tercemar ni, contohnya kalau kata dekat Sungai Semenyih tu selalulah dengar kan. And then kalau yang ni saya saja je tulis ni, yang ni bukan kat Malaysia ni, dekat Australia, skandal Watergate. Ni pun ada juga. So macam-macam. Okay, but then we have to know that for water safety plan as one of the main pillars within the apa ni, framework for safe drinking water under WHO. Okay, so yang ni lah modul-modul task yang ada. Yang apa yang kita kena tahulah. So I assume semua tahulah. Yang WSP modules yang bawah apa water safety plan manual ni yang 2009, the 11 modules, yang ni kira the complete set of the methodology. Okay, And then apa ni column, the next column ni yang water safety plan task ni yang ada 6 ni dia lebih untuk simplified water safety plans. Okay, di negara-negara maju ada yang nak buat. Boleh cari dan boleh baca lah kalau minat, especially di Iceland. Di Iceland ada, Australia ada, Australia in some parts saya tak ingat tapi memang ada. And then Canada pun ada. Apa ni, dia ada guna untuk simplified water safety plans. Kalau di Iceland boleh baca a few journal articles atas nama Maria Gunnarsdottir. So dia ada cerita, dia ada apa ya, cerita lah, banyaklah cerita dia pasal simplified water safety plans. Tapi dalam konteks di Iceland dia guna pendekatan CCP. So, okay, so yang tu pun boleh baca kalau minat. Dan ada lagi satu konteks di sini tak nyatakan sebab ini water safety plan. Satu lagi, sanitary inspection. So sanitary inspection ni dia supports apa ni, those apa ni, WSP methodology lah, especially yang mana yang tak boleh kita guna water safety plan, kita guna sanitary inspection. Okay. Okay, so water safety plan ni of course is very universal. Apa ni, WHO guna, IWA pun guna. Cuma apa ni, orang kata dalam konteks di peringkat negara lah, I would say nama tu macam-macam. Tak kisahlah nama apa pun, tapi yang penting metodologi tu sama. Yang inilah yang dipakai. Kalau untuk yang complete set of water safety plans ni, modul 1 sampai 11 pakai yang ni. Kalau untuk yang simplified version yang ni, 1 sampai 6 pakai yang ni. Buatlah macam mana pun, janji pakai metodologi ni dan gunalah nama apa pun. Macam dekat UK dengan New Zealand, dia guna pakai drinking water safety plan. Australia kat Malaysia ni saya rasa dalam apa ni, rang undang-undang kualiti air minum, dia guna nama sama macam dekat Victoria, drinking water quality risk management. Italy, drinking water risk management. Vancouver, Canada, drinking water quality assurance, drinking water management plan. One part in Australia, drinking water quality assurance program. Yang HACCP Malaysia sebut tadilah, Iceland, Greece, dia guna konteks HACCP dalam bentuk ni lah, tapi dia panggil HACCP. Okay. Dan pada masa yang sama, water safety plans ni dia ada ni interconnection with those ni lah. So that's why lah banyak lah apa ni, water treatment plants kan, water utilities, water companies yang ada ni all those certifications. Mungkin ada lagi yang saya tak nyatakan di sini, tapi they complement each other actually, very useful lah. So okay, yang ini dalam guidelines for drinking water quality 4th edition 2011. Macam saya sebut tadi, dia kata water safety plans represent an evolution of the concept of sanitary surveys and vulnerability assessments that include. So mana kata water safety plans ni dia evolve daripada sanitary surveys yang tahun 1976 tadi ni, dia jadi water safety plans 2004. Okay, so apa ni, yang sekarang ni yang KKM guna sanitary kajian kebersihan tu, kita bolehlah bertukar kepada water safety plans. And bear in mind, it's not stand alone. It's actually the whole system lah, in terms of drinking water quality management. Okay, so yang ni dalam manual. Okay, sebab ada pendekatan sebelum ni, faham water safety plan ni cuba untuk quality aja. No, it's not. Dia approach dia lebih daripada tu lagi. Boleh baca lanjut dalam manual. Okay. Alright. So, global uptake, water safety plan. Satu dunia. Ni survey based on 180 countries. 93 negara, maksudnya tahun 2018 dah ada melaksanakan water safety plan dalam macam-macam bentuk dan dalam macam-macam peringkat. So boleh carilah dokumen ni dan boleh baca. Ni termasuk Malaysia lah. Okay. Okay, so yang ni pula, okay. Okay, water safety plans in terms of the flexibility of usage. Apa ni? Dia boleh guna dalam pelbagai size, resources levels, complex urban water supplies pun boleh, yang kecil pun boleh, yang self supply system pun boleh. Self supply system ni contohnya macam telaga yang dikorek sendiri di rumah-rumah di Kota Baru contohnya. So as alternative supply lah, walaupun dia ada public water supply daripada AKSB ke rumah, tapi pada masa yang sama because of certain issues dia adalah dia punya apa self supply system, dia gali telaga ke ataupun what not ke kan. And of course WSP dia supports other institutional settings, buildings, ships, aviation. Okay, yang ni pun ada dia punya apa ni, orang kata details, details in each documentation lah for those settings. And of course, water safety plans ni it depends on apa ni orang kata scope of implementation. Ada setengah apa ni water suppliers ni macam kat UK dia water companies lah sebab semua privatized. So dia macam dekat Yorkshire Water, Severn Trent, dia boleh include daripada catchment sampai ke kat sana tak ada meter, sampai ke point dekat sebelum dapur tu, dekat kitchen tap tu, dekat yard tu, dia boleh exclude water safety plans. Of course dia punya sampling sampai dalam rumah dan that's actually been stated in their regulations, you know, for sampling. And for Malaysian context, that will be different lah. Macam yang ni yang saya letak ni based on apa ni orang kata scope operasi dan juga scope pelaksanaan water safety plans based on operasi lah. Masa ni ada Syabas sebab tu ada distribution operator privatized kan masa ni. Sekarang dah tak ada. So that will be another story. But of course the scenario will be something like this lah. Okay. Alright, so untuk global uptake water safety plans ni lah contoh dekat Malaysia lah as recommended. Urban water supplies, rural water supplies. Urban water supplies, as I mentioned, ada self supply system, ada public water supply system, ada yang kecil, ada yang besar, kan? And then ada untuk institutions, untuk bangunan, sekolah, rumah, rumah bertingkat, hospital, macam-macam. Then untuk rural water supplies pun sama, community manage. Lepas tu ada pula yang daripada public water supply systems. So yang ni actually, okay. Kaedah lah sama ada nak buat untuk self supply system ni nak buat apa lah. Ada tiga kan. Ada full water safety plans, ada simplified water safety plans, ada safety inspections. So self supply systems mungkin boleh buat safety inspection. So yang ni boleh lah orang daripada PKD ke buat kan. Contoh okay, untuk public water supply systems, large treatment works, water safety plans. Untuk small treatment works, okay, mungkin boleh buat water safety plans. Or mungkin boleh buat simplified water safety plans. It depends. Depends to the water utilities lah nak buat macam mana ini kan. Sebab sometimes it depends on the resources as well and so forth. Ini semua kita boleh lihat lah in terms of the demarcation of implementation. Alright, so ni modul 1. Okay, ini saya ambil dalam konteks yang modul 1 sampai modul 11. There are key actions, there are the output, siapa yang kita kena buat dan juga typical challenges. Okay, modul 1 ni of course ni lebih kepada forming a team. Okay, and then modul 2 ni kita nak describe and document the system. Ni lebih kepada identify and assess identify hazards and risks, you know. So apa ni, nanti apa ni, most of the information ni ada dalam manual, tapi sebab saya rasa masa untuk apa ni, boleh baca, saya tak cedok lah kan, tapi saya tak cedok 100%, but then apa ni, ada apa ni orang kata information yang yang relevant saya masukkan juga based on my apa ni, understanding lah. And apa ni, so yang ini yang paling penting, keywords yang kita patut tahu, hazard and hazardous event, sebab those tu akan create risk. Possibilitynya untuk create risk tu adalah, so of course daripada sini untuk risk assessment, macam mana kita nak guna risk matrix. Risk matrix ni apa ni, apa kaitan dia dengan hazard dan hazardous event. Risk matrix ni kalau apa ni orang kata amalannya di negara-negara maju, setiap water utility tu dia create sendiri dia punya risk matrix. It's not been designed solely by the regulator. Macam yang ni kan, yang ni daripada MOH ni. Based on risk appetite masing-masing lah. Sebab apa ni, loji duduk tempat lain-lain kan, kawasan tak sama, konteks berbeza. So I mean apa ni orang kata, apa ni, risk matrix ni supposed to be designed by each water supplier. But then of course macam mana regulator nak regulate, yang tu ada trick dia lah. Yang tu sebab bila risk matrix berbeza kan, dia punya apa ni orang kata, hasil dia, scoring dia akan berbeza sebab risk matrix berbeza kan. So yang tu akan ada satu mekanism yang diguna pakai oleh regulator untuk standardize those apa ni, risk lah based on the scoring tu kan. Yang tu dia ada trick dia. Yang tu kena belajar lebih. InsyaAllah boleh cerita. Tak ada masalah. So yang ni pula apa ni, of course kita nak apa ni, kata in terms of kita nak determine and validate and as well as to prioritize risk. Yang ni dia punya ni, ni lah keyword dia. Countermeasures, validation, risk. Countermeasures ni ada setengah orang pakai various mitigation measures kan. Of course countermeasures ni dia tak boleh satu, dia kena lebih satu. That's why ada pakai konsep multi barrier approach. Yang ni ada modeling, Swiss cheese modeling, apa ni, ada Suan Mamat ni nama dia, Reason, dia ada apa ni, dia ada cerita lanjut lah. Okay, so this is why we need countermeasures. Okay, some of the incidents dekat Malaysia tak pernah dengar lagi pasal apa ni, incident related to Cryptosporidium pavum. Okay, but then negara lain ada, boleh baca nanti kalau apa ni, at the end of the webinar nanti kita akan bagi slides kan, boleh tengok lah. Yang ni dekat Missouri, USA pun glamour juga incident ni. Yang ni tak berapa sangat. Walkerton, ni pun sangat glamour. Dia punya insiden ni memang terhangat di pasaran masa ni lah. Yang ni, ni dekat Malaysia. Yang ni dekat US. Yang ni the latest one. Memang sampai sekarang tak selesai lagi. So memang banyak. That's why we need countermeasures. Okay, so ada setengah countermeasures tu kita tak dapat laksanakan dengan segera. So we need improvement plan. So this is within the module 5. Module 6, define monitoring plan. Okay, so yang ni kita kena faham dia punya definition ni lah. Critical limit, corrective action. And then of course, apa ni, verification ni, module 7, the verification triangle, tiga ni kena tahu, compliance monitoring, auditing and consumer satisfaction, that needs to know. Yang ni, okay, apa beza antara operational monitoring or compliance monitoring? Okay. So yang ni, apa ni, orang kata, kena faham. So dalam konteks ni dia kata, durability testing by the water supplier at the filter. So yang ini ialah operational monitoring, not compliance monitoring, sebab tak ada elemen regulator regulating. Okay, so saya rasa masa pun dah nak ni. So yang ni tadi saya dah sebut in terms of operational monitoring dan juga verification, operational monitoring to ensure the control measure works effectively. While this is actually for WSP as a whole. Okay, and validation and verification needs to understand as well apa beza dia. Okay, as well as okay, we go through a few modules. Okay, so module 10 and 11 more on review. Okay, so di ini pun ada beza juga within verification and review. So this needs to be understood. This is a sanitary inspections. Okay, ada dokumennya, ada WHO sanitary inspections. Dia lebih kepada checklist. Okay, and comparison with the some testing results. Okay, safe drinking water, especially for community at community level. Okay, so yang ni nak kena balance lah between front end dengan back end.
Nak share full sekarang ke?
Yes.
Tak boleh?
Yes.
Can we take 3 minutes to share the poll first?
Yes.
Alright. Yes, there's polling going on. I'll share the poll now. Please do answer them. Ada 3 question. Okay, it's live now. Ada tak? Can you get it? Ada dapat tak semua orang?
Nampak. Mira, cannot see.
Cannot see?
Well, you all can see it. Ada.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Let's take 2 minutes before I'll publish the results. There's 3 questions, yeah?
3 questions. You can scroll down. Scroll the questions.
Meanwhile, Dr. Hafiza, there's 3 questions ready in your chat. I'll send it to your chat box.
Okay.
Nak komen?
Okay.
Mansur ni.
Ayu, Cik Mansur.
Soalan ni kalau saya boleh jawab, dia the first three tu semua betul tu, sebab memang ada yang buat development lagi, ada yang sedang implement dan ada yang senggara yang dah buat 5 tahun buat. Jadi soalan tu dah susah sikit lah nak kata tepat sangat kan. Kalau pilih mana-mana pun macam betul.
Betul lah. Semua betul lah.
Tapi tak ada pilihan tu.
Kalau lepas semua betul.
Contohnya kan.
Dia tak kata satu betul.
Betul lah.
Not sure.
Tak
tahu lah.
Tak tahu. Tiga-tiga say the top three tu betul semua. Jadi
okay, we have 45 answers already. Can I close the poll now?
Yeah.
Ada lagi tak orang jawab?
Still it's still increasing lah. Tengah increase lagi, Mr. Lee. Tunggu je ah.
Tunggu je. Tunggu.
Belum habis 3 minit. Baru 1 minit. Magician. Susah soalan satu tu susah nak jawab.
No, this one in terms of Haji Mansur, this in terms of your ranking lah, like, which is the most.
Which is the majority lah kan.
Yeah. Which one is the, you think is more advanced than the other?
Yeah. The most, okay, right. That's a good, yeah. good tip.
Masuk tak jawab, mana jawab.
Ingat soalan nombor 1 tu ikut weightage je.
Ya.
Pemberat. Mana yang paling berat itulah jawapan.
Yeah, weightage. Only if you know the numbers, you know, you have the statistics, you bolehlah jawab. Kalau tak ada statistics,
Tradition is for others who do not know the situation, so right. Their own guess lah. Huh? What they feel yeah. Is the correct answer. Or is the status now?
Actually, WSP ni dah lama senyap ni.
Dormant.
Dulu hangat betul.
Okay, Mira, berapa dah?
Dah 59 over 83. So I end the poll now.
And let Dr. Riza make some comment.
Okay.
Sebelum tu, sebelum tu saya nak tanya Dr. Fiza, you skip a few slides. Are you rushing for time? How much time left actually for this masterclass?
Itulah. I kalau boleh nak cerita. Tapi kan.
Ya, sayanglah. The skip.
Apa, memory and we can have an hour more. No? We will have an hour more. Lepas tu, kalau ada patu, patu lah. Tak apa. Kita consolidate semula, kita buat part two.
Oh, okay, okay.
Buat deeper one, huh? Deeper one.
Okay. Okay. Close now, yeah.
Close.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Okay, now I'll share the results.
Oh, okay. Tough fight lah.
Yes, my answer is right.
Ya.
Soalan satu
tapi
ni.
Tapi yang tamat.
Why is the WSP soalan terhangat lah kira kan? Sebab apa ni? Tak boleh nak jawab. Boleh lah juga nak jawab kat sini kan. Ada komen ke untuk soalan nombor satu? Why is the WSP?
Soalan nombor satu saya ni saya nak bagi komen sikit lah. Kalau ikutkan kita ni negara maju ni, WSP ni patut dah ada. Kita yang tak buat. Itu aja jawapan saya. Kita dah should start. Dah lama dah program ni dimulakan oleh WHO.
Just do it.
Kalau tak buat, tak jalan. Itu aja. Kan? Apa lagi tu? Ya, jadi negara maju macam Malaysia ni sepatutnya dah mula. Tak perlu kita tangguh-tangguh lagi. Patut water for value dah kena buat dah semua.
Tuan Zul, saya nak respon boleh?
Ya.
Yeah. Dia begini. Yeah. Dalam Asia dah ada undang-undang termasuk dengan sewerage safety plan. Cuma SPAN selama ni dia tidak enforce lah dan tidak pesu pun. Tapi KKM yang bukan regulator sibuk. Dia yang jadi champion lah, which kita appreciate. Tapi orang yang berkenaan tu duduk tepi. Tapi baru-baru ni saya dengar SPAN dah mula gerakkan.
Kena mula, patutnya kita mula. Kalau kita tak mula, langkah. Jadi, bila kita nak maju?
Malaysia ni kena rotan jugalah. Kena rotan
ya, kena rotan juga. Kalau tidak, kita nak jaga public, the quality of the public receiving the water to ensure this integrity our agency.
Bolehlah.
Yes, water safety must be implemented.
Nak tanya
otherwise kita
Nak tanya Puan Hafizah, numbers tu. Yes. Kita nak sembang-sembang sikit lah. Kalau Puan Hafizah cakap dengan screen penat juga kan. The numbers currently berapa WSP daripada 400 over water system di Malaysia? Tapi itu termasuk Sabah Sarawak lah. Kalau you minus Sabah Sarawak under your jurisdiction, berapa tu dalam berapa tu?
Saya nak jawab pun tak boleh Encik Masu sekarang ni. Sebab apa? Yang ada dalam grup ni ada apa ni daripada Kembang punya team kan. Sebab saya tak masuk team tu lah sekarang. So maybe dia orang boleh jawab sekarang ni macam mana ni water safety plan status untuk Teban water supply kat Malaysia ni. Siapa-siapa boleh jawab ke?
Span ada
momen yang problem ada.
Boleh unmute je.
Hairul. Amir,
boleh tanya ke Amir. I'm from a different sector, tapi kalau Kemam tahu, dia boleh jawab lah yang mana yang agensinya dah laksanakan apa water safety plan ni. I'm pun ada dia ada figures, tapi The latest one, I'm not sure on that.
Figures tu ada. Sebab masa saya dengan Kemam dulu, what I did, saya buat macam traffic light punya, punya colour tau. Merah, amber, hijau. So mana mana apa ni, water utilities with water utilities I detail out to the water supply systems. Sebab ada setengah tu dia tak buat secara comprehensive for the whole system. Dia buat untuk water treatment work sahaja, water treatment plant sahaja. So I need to see that, you know, from that point of view as well. So what I did is satu yang yang level pilot project aja. Masa tu ada pilot projects. Okay, and then go for the apa ni development. Okay, and then ada juga for implementation and as well as apa ni orang kata going for apa ni review lah. Review of the implementation. But now I'm not so sure the the figures for for the WSP status untuk urban water supplies in Malaysia. But during my time when I was with Kemam team, that was what I did. Try to figure out, try to classify those based on these stages lah.
Assalamualaikum.
Salam.
Saya nak jelas sikit. Since I don't know whether this is a Q&A ke tidak, tapi terpanggil jugalah on the WSP. Saya setuju dengan Cik Zul. Saya juga setuju juga dengan Haji Mansor. Hanya this presentation by Puan is very good. I think it's open up the eyes of everyone who attend this session. Hanya saya punya pendapat on the way forward. We have been talking for a long time. A lot of parties talk about the WSP, tapi the implementation is wrong. I always say in most of my comments in such event macam ni pun, we are lack of enforcement. Pihak yang berwajib sorok diri, tak timbul ke depan. So we are lack of drivers. So it's about time. Macam NGO like MWA ni, we have put up a lot of memorandum. This time round, kena hubung memorandum and put it in the media to show the threats. That's what you show just now, Puan, the case in overseas. Do you want it to be to happen in Malaysia? Are we proactive or active? So kalau kita nak death, so we wait for death lah. So kalau nak prevent, then we should do it now. I'm sure some auto operators tak ada benda ni, let alone for sewerage. So it's about time that we put up a strong memorandum. Kalau boleh, sign up by all the NGOs to put a strong message to the government that this is a must and this need to be monitored so that it happens. Pasal kita dah terlampau jauh ke belakang. Yes, so that's my thought on this. Well, it's a good presentation and it need to be shared with the public. Thank you.
Saya nak jadi isu ni, isu pasal logi treatment, water treatment kita ni lah. Memang kebanyakan dia conventional treatment dah lama dah, zaman zaman 70-an 80-an pun ada lagi pakai kan.
Betul.
Whether are we ready to face the this logi-logi ni? Itu pun questionable juga. Why kita tunggu this water treatment pun tak ada improvement lagi kan? Dah lama dah. Yeah. Yang water supply apa yang gunakan conventional ni, treatment ni masih lagi digunakan, whether kita boleh pass ke WSP ni. Ya, ini yang satu apa? Satu
betul itu
lah untuk
I think part of the answer here. Conventional
water treatment
agree Cik Zul.
Yes.
I think part of the answer here, kita dalam MWA, kita ada usulkan pada kerajaan. Under current situation, I have to say get again. The one of the issues here is low tariff. People are not paying for the right tariff. So you cannot, you have a first class facility with third class mentality tak jali. So in order to help the public, I think there's no harm to abstract a bit, at least 1 sen ke 2 sen, 3 sen daripada bill kita ni, kita park kepada R&D fund. And that R&D fund is to go back to the water operators to improve their punya system. Because no one system fit for all. Macam di Kelantan, masalah dia lain. Di Johor lain. But they lack of fund. Kalau dia nak contribute kat sini, dia kita macam kita punya krisis sekarang ni. Kita nak close down shop because of safety ataupun kita continue but sacrifice safety, life. So decision must be made. What is the priority? So kita ada mesti, kita ada fund. But why are all this R&D fund? And then banyak orang buat R&D. I think auto operator pun buat R&D. Span pun buat R&D. So I think Span have to play its role. To have a center ke, kalau tak ada pun, government have to create another body just looking at the R&D as what you say. Kita ni banyak mewarisi saka lah. Especially RWK, saka-saka yang diambil daripada dulu punya sistem, still there. And when you upgrade dia punya water quality, they are caught. And they've been summoned for something that, you know, macam contoh di kadang ni, some of the water operator punya dilemma is on sludge or residue dia panggil. Yep. Itu pun dilemma juga. It's easy to say, just correct sana, letak sini, but there's cost. And this is where, moving forward, I totally agree with you, Cik Zul. We may need to push to the government to enforce something. Kalau tidak, kita akan berada di sini. Another 5-10 years, you'll be talking on the same matter, but different people. Itu saya punya thought lah.
Another thing yang saya thinking ni, kalau kita ada macam strategic plan for WHP, at least kita tak boleh implement semua dulu lah. At least kita ada step-step until we achieve the 100% compliant with the English WHP. At least we must develop. I ingat benda ni dah lama, patutnya kita dah ada at least the strategy, stages.
Yep.
Kita tak boleh buat semua, kita buatlah separuh dulu. Separuh sikit-sikit, lama-lama jadi bukit. Tak bolehlah kita tak mulakan langsung kan. Yang mana logi-logi yang tak terlibat, yang tak buat WHP tu, kita at least dia do something. Start satu dua dulu. Yes. And then toward
one of the
way, yes.
Yeah, one of the way is to put India KPI lah. Where we have our rep today, Tuan Haji Dr. Aisari. Hopefully he can convey all this thought to SPAN, being in the board of SPAN, so he can say all this and put in the KPI. Boleh buru dalam KPI kot.
Okay, kita cuba kata kalau kita bincang panjang pun dia tak ke mana juga. I would like to just bring up 2 points. Number one, on the part of Malaysian Water Association, kita baru tubuhkan, dia panggil Water Security and Sustainability, which have to look into. Kita letak pun the right person lah, Mansur Ghani to lead lah. So Mansur Ghani ni memang minat lah WSP. Cara dia bercakap tadi pun saya nampak dia, he has the passion and I want to see things macam apa ni Zul sebut tadi pun, Datuk Kadir sebut, all these things has to be put in the plan lah. And then bila kita dah ada proper plan, then kita boleh cerita lah yang lain. And secondly, actually is on part of SPAN itself, kita dah start putting inside the KPI, WSP. You tanyalah kepada water operator tu how they feel about after SPAN dah start letak WSP as the KPI. So I think these are actually the yang kita buat program macam ni pun is actually macam tadi sebut lah, is not only just an eye opener or awareness, is actually working towards a workable plan for us to see changes lah. So changes, sekarang ni is all in our hands actually, and we are considered as orang yang paling berpengalaman dan berpengaruh dalam dalam kerajaan, untuk boleh mempengaruhi kerajaan. So we will do our work lah. Kita akan buat kerja-kerja kita lah. Kalau kita tak plan betul-betul, tak dapat. So I think mungkin Mansur nak cerita, dia lebih mahir lagi bidang WSP ni. Mungkin dia ada plan dia macam mana. Sorry lah, kita nak masuk Q&A automatik.
Kita dah ada satu session lagi. Presentation first. Lepas tu kita sambung Q&A.
Mr. Lee, kita ada satu session.
Boleh lagi. Boleh tak masukkan jam lagi.
Alamak,
buat forum lah. Buat forum Dr. Asari. Saya show buat forum
buat donation.
Saya tak nak ambil masa Puan Hafizah.
Hafizah lah.
Yalah.
Hafizah.
Alright. It's a hot topic. Yeah,
kita buat
forum. Okay, sorry lah. Seronok tajuk ni, seronok.
Tapi memang is
presentation ni.
It's a
okay. So are we closing the poll results?
Alright, can I start sharing, yeah?
Dah. Close.
Itulah.
Okay.
So that's actually the concern, right? That we have talked just now. And soalan last sekali, how confident are we to drink water directly from the household tap in Malaysia? Mostly jawab neutral.
saya nak bagi saya nak bagi satu pandangan saya boleh eh? Kalau how confident drinking water in our soul ni, kalau air tu dia terus ke tangki, tangki not maintain, saya pun tak confident nak minum. Sebab kalau macam bangunan-bangunan di hotel ke apa ke, yang bangunan apa kedai-kedai ke yang
sediakan right, air,
dia dalam bangunan ni there's no maintenance. Kalau direct pipe tu mungkin kita boleh confident lah, tapi kalau dia go to the tangki and then distribute to the for drinking, saya lebih prefer Kowei or whatever yang filter tu daripada air minum terus. There's a level lah, level of confidence yang saya pandang lah. Sebab kebanyakan ni tak ada macam satu rule. Kalau in building ni dia tak ada somebody control ni.
Ada, it depends. Kalau water, yes. Bangunan yang yes. ada JMB tu, yes. Okay, okay. I nak jawab satu soalan ni. Apa ni, before I proceed, ada...
I sharing the poll punya ni, results.
Sorry?
I stop sharing the poll results, ya? Yeah?
Yes, yes, please. Ada satu soalan ni, dia tanya pasal apa ni, transition. Recognizing the transition and eventually the application of risk-based approach for drinking water quality management. Would the water quality standards by Engineering Services Division of MOH issues years back still applicable for current and foreseeable future in Malaysia? Of course, as I mentioned just now, the guidelines was formulated in 2000, that was 21 years ago, and then been reviewed in 2004. Not much review anyway, but there was some reviews been included in the manual kemam. But then looking into the future, kalau di negara-negara maju, in terms of the risk-based approach yang diguna pakai, they are talking about wholesome drinking water. Meaning to say, kalau ada issue, incidents ke, incidents lah especially on near misses, kalau ada case yang melibatkan hazard and hazardous event, macam tadilah ceritanya macam Flint water crisis, Walkerton Canada kan, contoh-contoh yang saya apa ni tunjuk secara laju tadi tu kan, some of the parameters would be akan emerge kemudian yang tak termasuk dalam standard. So kita, bila bercakap tentang standard, that's actually those parameters yang dalam standard. But how about those yang tak masuk dalam standard? That's why di negara-negara maju, dia consider on macam kat UK, dia lihat kepada wholesome drinking water. Meaning to say, tak semestinya yang tertakluk, parameter yang tertakluk dalam standard. Termasuk juga apa-apa parameter yang emerge ke yang kemudian yang tak termasuk dalam standard tapi memberi kesan kepada kesihatan awam, yes, that will be contribute to the unwholesome drinking water that be considered for apa ni risk based approach lah, whatever that you want to do, apa ni, you nak tambah countermeasures ke, what you want to do to mitigate that kind of risk. That's actually the simple word that I can put in. So itulah saya boleh jawab. Hopefully satisfy orang yang bertanya soalan tu lah. And the second one is pasal presentation today. Yes, tadi pun ada apa ni, organizer pada sebut will be shared with the participants. Okay, alright. So
sorry, we have to cut the slides at 4:30.
Alright.
Take questions and answer. If is that okay?
Saya flip dulu few things, mm-hmm. and then apa ni? Kita stop lah, boleh?
Alright. Okay? Thank you so much. Sorry,
okay.
Yeah.
That's sorry okay. So of course there are proven benefits of water safety plans. And tadi ada sebut pasal IWRM, of course there are, and as mentioned earlier, IWRM ni tools dia lebih kepada governance arrangement. dia kurang actionable framework kalau ada issues how to tackle that through countermeasures, for example, yang tu tak ada. That's actually being complemented by water safety plans dalam konteks ni lah. So of course also in terms of water security, that's actually answering to the SDG 6 as well, universal and equitable access to safe and affordable drinking water for all. So water security as the Global Water Partnership mentioned, so it's actually beyond water safety plans, of course, because sort of like a water safety ni actually orang kata subset to the water security because there's a lot. Banyak terminologi, but secara sebikas ni macam itulah in terms of water security, drinking water quality surveillance, yang ni actually one of the main pillars within the framework that I mentioned earlier that need to be embraced. And of course I agreed from the discussion earlier on the enforcement part and how to work between regulatory agencies, for example, and MOH actually dia lebih kepada kuasi regulator, walaupun dia bukan regulator to lean, dia tak ada akta yang dia enforce, tetapi dia kuasi regulator because dia dapat kuasa daripada WHO. So that's to need to be bear in mind lah. Ada saya sebut awal-awal tadi sebelum ni, punca kuasa daripada WHO through the World Health Assembly. Yang tu sebab mungkin kita kat Malaysia ni orang tak tahu, so saya bagi tahulah. Okay, so drinking water quality surveillance, okay, and then activity yang sepatutnya ada. Dan water safety plans ni dia inform risk-based surveillance. Okay, whatever that we do, the water operators laksanakan through water safety plans, they inform this part. Okay, yang ni ada cerita, yang ni lebih kepada some parts of the water safety plans including auditing. Yang ni pun ada dia punya detail out dia lah. Okay, country experience and case examples. Okay, banyak negara dah buat. Okay, kita je yang tak berapa nak ni kan, sendu sikit lah. Dia ada komponen-komponen yang terlibat. Okay, this is a very detail components involved. Okay, contoh macam negara maju ni, yang ni ada. Tapi yang ni yang kurang, components of water safety plans ni, the methodology being used. Contohnya yang sebelas tadi tu, ada yang tak termasuk. That's why dekat US, dia ada Clean Water Crisis, walaupun dia ada undang-undang. Dia ada Drinking Water, dia ada Safe Drinking Water Act 1974. Because of this, some of the steps, some of the modules dalam water safety plans ni dia tak ikut, berlaku ni. Okay. Alright, that's why I mentioned here, risk of unnecessary monitoring of contaminants ada, tapi they overlook locally critical risk, sebab tu berlaku Flint water crisis. And as mentioned, regulatory push is a need. Ni dekat UK, and these are actually all those key actors yang support water sector lah, water industry di UK. Macam-macam jenis ada. And then this is actually the setup, the institutional and also the regulatory framework, instruments and strategies involved within the water services in England. Okay, ni the regulatory tools and strategies. Yang ni nak kena berguru lebih sikit, dia tak boleh guru sekarang sebab banyak. But just a glance. Okay, yang ni contoh di Scottish Water. Apa yang dia nak buat, in a very simple way to demonstrate. Cogan kata IWA, dan ini yang dia pegang. Wholesome drinking water. So this is what you mentioned on wholesome drinking water in their regulation. Okay, and metrics, risk metrics, as I mentioned, is supposed to be designed by water utilities as well. Each water utility, yang ni dia design untuk public health. compliance kalau dia nak buat reporting apa semua kan, because data banyak dekat logi, dekat Water Utility. So ada data untuk compliance, so dia guna yang ni untuk reporting, serviceability untuk O&M. Okay, ini database yang dia guna pakai untuk risk assessment dan macam mana dia respond to the risk category been stipulated by the Drinking Water Inspectorate, the regulator in the UK. Yang ni sebab masing-masing ada risk matrix sendiri, so dia orang buat reporting. So this some of the formats dia buat reporting monthly. Dia apa ni, dia akan rationalize dengan this risk category untuk apa ni, drinking untuk DWI purposes lah. Dia nak buat auditing ke, dia buat enforcement ke kan. So yang ni pula index. Dia dulu masa zaman compliance based approach tu di UK dia pakai mean zonal compliance. Yang tu dia punya index yang dia pakai. Sama dia punya CASTA dia dengan index kat Malaysia untuk QAP dan juga Drinking Water Quality Index. Sama. But then once they use risk based approach, dia ada dua. Satu compliance risk index, another one is event risk index. Okay, so yang ni dia punya apa ni, for assurance lah. Okay, yang ni dia punya collaboration. Okay, inter-agencies. Okay, some of the references that involve that included for water safety plans, a lot, banyak, ni sikit tapi banyak lah. Based on various aspects of water safety planning, boleh dapat daripada link ni and also from the water safety portal. Okay, macam-macam ada. Okay, and of course journal articles pun banyak, boleh baca Jamie Bertram, Mary Gunasdotir, banyak. And of course food for thought, what's next for water safety plans, debatable lah. Do they sit on a shelf or are they being continuously updated? So how were the water safety plans done differently by different water utilities? So what were the practical benefits and challenges of the water safety plan approach? And what could be done differently next time? Okay, food for thought. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you. Itu aja.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hafiza. So sorry to rush you. I guess we can open the floor for question and answer now. Boleh ya, Doktor?
Boleh cakap-cakap.
Boleh cakap-cakap.
Orang kan?
Sekarang bolehlah unmute everyone. Siapa yang nak bercakap, boleh.
Oh, ada soalan. Ada soalan yang last kali tu. Dalam apa? Dalam WhatsApp. Dalam chat group tu.
Doktor, I send you the questions just now.
Okay. Yang we have been using National Drinking Water Standards since 2000 and the new emerging contaminants that keep discharging to our river and public health concern keep rising. What is the initiative so far by MOH to stay up to date with the emerging contaminants in our drinking water? Okay, ni kat sini ni ada orang MOH ni yang jaga Kemam. Mungkin orang Kemam dia tolong jawab ni.
Okay.
Tadi ada saya tanya pasal berapa bilangan water safety plan yang telah diwujudkan lah, mungkin dalam pelbagai peringkat. Ada daripada KKM saya rasa wakilnya Puan Dalilah jawab 100, sekitar 100 termasuk Sabah Sarawak. So that is only about 25% saja of whole of Malaysia where we have about 400 plus treatment plants. So 25% tu taklah banyak.
Yang tu lebih pada documentation aja.
Yalah, itu pun dah tak capai macam mana.
Apa ni Puan Hafiza, boleh saya tanya sikit?
Hello.
Tak, saya nak tanya, information yang you gather ni, is it as a role that people give to you ataupun just abstract as and when? Maksudnya, contoh, saya ambil contoh, SPAN, dia dapat information daripada all water operators on all the data on water data lah. Dia punya revenue ke apa semua. Tapi kalau macam WSP ni, is it you are the central body who collect and they give voluntarily atau is it mandatory?
Saya saya ambil konsep apa ni modeling di England lah yang dekat dengan kita lah. Okay. Okay, kalau okay. Kalau di England di UK dia punya konsep dia macam ni. Macam apa ni reporting reporting daripada water utilities dia akan report in terms of the risk assessment setiap bulan through the apa ni database tadi tu dia buat online dia hantar kepada DWI. So DWI akan guna that apa ni orang kata information dalam bentuk risk assessment tadi tu untuk aktiviti dia lah untuk auditing untuk buat enforcement ataupun untuk let's say kalau kata the whole England and Wales they seems to be like ada issues general issues let's say fluoride okay how they want to tackle that so they akan go for kata team team audit dipanggil team audit just just to apa ni just to
focus.
Yes, just to apa ni orang kata investigate on that issue and then they will come back and apa ni put up a report for the water industry and for each of the water industry to resolve on that lah. Contohnya, saya rasa saya ada tunjuk kat sini. Okay, fluoride levels in water supply zones. Kalau dekat Malaysia, kita ada certain range of standards right for fluoride. So same goes dengan dekat sana lah sebab based on standard daripada WHO as well. Cuma sebab fluoride ni kawasan yang berbeza sebab dia daripada sumber daripada natural kan. Dan ada satu lagi dia by dosing. Apa ni selalunya dental lah. Dia, kat sana pun ada isu juga dengan dental. So apa ni dia akan buat zoning of fluoride punya based on range. Kan macam mana dia go on with it but and this is actually based on the team audit yang apa ni yang dia buat di peringkat DWI lah. So those actually the apa ni the information the compliance information that DWI ambil guna untuk dia orang punya aktiviti lah. Macam lagi satu kalau kata untuk bila dia communicate dengan Ofwat, satunya dalam bentuk 5-year price review or business plan from apa ni water utilities. Water utilities kalau dia nak go for improvement plan sebab dalam water safety plan dia ada satu modul on improvement plan. So dia akan go kepada DWI to endorse that plan lah for that. So Ofwat tak akan terima kalau DWI tak endorse. Itulah dia punya apa ni orang kata cara dia orang bekerja lah.
They try to
complement each other.
Great, I think this is Ofwat punya matrix yang dulu lah masa kita cuba follow for our water researching. But currently in Malaysia, I know what we mentioned SPAN ada dia punya itu semua tapi tak ada enforcement. But currently siapa yang oversee this WSP being implemented?
By right and wish. Because guidelines, WHO guidelines, they stated the most competent health authority. So the most competent health authority kalau kat Malaysia ni of course lah MOH.
I think I tend to agree tapi ada bercanggah tak dengan SPAN sekarang ni?
Tak sebab saya rasa dalam RUU yang MOH nak sediakan masa saya dululah masa saya membantu di dalam formulating the RUU dia lebih kepada to complement because masa dulu masa di apa ni dibuat IUU WISA dulu tak ada apa ni masa ni masa dulu saya ingat dulu masa saya dengan Datin Mariah dah dululah masa kami duk buat discussion dengan KSU Ketok dulu tak ingat apa ni, kita masukkan elemen satu in terms of water safety plans dengan apa ni, sewerage sanitation safety plan tu kan, ada dua right. Dalam clause one of the clauses, tak saya rasa clause tak ingat 81, tak ingat dah. So dalam clause tu ada apa ni, those two dimasukkan, tetapi in terms of pelaksanaan kalau untuk water safety plans ni lebih kepada KKM lah. Sebab
okay. Yeah, I think jelas lah kalau itu. Saya pun setuju. Biar MOH jaga. Because PAN ni dah terlalu banyak. They can put in the KPI. But the body must be MOH. I think it's by right. If it's mandatory, so it's about time. Macam Cik Zul cakap tadi, need to be enforced lah. Kalau tidak, kena penalize lah. Because this is preventive. Because by showing all those examples tadi, I appreciate what you show just now. What happened to other country walaupun tak datang ke negara kita lagi. Tapi takkan nak tunggu sampai dia datang kan. So okay, at least I'm clear now who is the right apa ni body yang should be monitoring. Okay, masih.
Thank you. Doctor, can I take questions from the chat box?
Which one?
Okay, ada from Ahmad Salihin Syed Said. Digitalization approach such as online monitoring or real-time monitoring approach, is there any study on such approach?
Kalau dekat overseas banyak, dekat Malaysia ni I'm not so sure lah kan. And then masa saya di Cranfield University dulu pun memang banyak collaboration dibuat di antara pihak water companies dengan university lah dalam konteks ni. Kalau untuk especially untuk catchment area because of the the risk is more significant from the catchment areas, not to mention that from other water supply system from the treatment processes or distribution or even from the household, there are risks. But in this case, because most of those are actually uncontrolled risks that not within the purview of the water operators, but then they try their best to have that kind of R&D collaborating with the university so that that can have the benefits at their end, you know, for the implementation of the water safety plans.
Okay, thank you. And there's another one from Pao Yun Ching. Is CNG in our drinking need to test often as we are using a lot surface water for drinking? Is CNG in our CNG? Pao Yun Ching, let me check if she's
CNG actually is crypto jadia.
Oh, the protozoa, cryptosporidium pavum and jadia lamblia.
Yeah.
Okay. Dia sebab test dia mahal kan, sebab tu kita tak buat kat Malaysia kan. And then lagi satu yang saya ingat dulu ada dekat MOH dia ada buat testing, and then because the UCIS tu tak dapat dikesan at certain level of the water treatment processes. So there's no urgency at that time, but I'm not so sure now due to the pollutants lah apa semua kan, and then because of the development trends, urbanization lah apa semua kan, kita tak tahu. But then jadi alam liar not really, but cryptosporidium pavum yes. That was actually mandatory in the UK to do the sampling, but not here. So as far as I know lah.
Assalamualaikum puan.
Salam.
Saya Sheila Ashila daripada Jabatan Kesihatan Negeri Selangor. Saya tak tahu whether this is a good platform to ask you. Sebab in Selangor kita ada banyak kejadian water crisis. Macam untuk tahun 2020 it happened 4 times. Jadi loji tutup for a while untuk investigate those issue. So yang kita found out 4 kali tu water crisis tu is on pencemaran bau lah. So pencemaran bau it's actually pencemaran sisa daripada industri, and I just want to know whether how do we macam mana what's the indicator of bau? Adakah ada tak bau ni indicator dalam RUU ke macam mana? Thank you Puan.
Ini kena tanya Group Kemam lah Cik Oi, because I can't answer this for now, but I know that in the guidelines, in the WHO guidelines, there isn't apa ni, those kind of parameter. But of course, that's actually included when we considered on the risk, the parameters is about the acceptability. So when we are talking about wholesome drinking water, it's not about the hazards, the hazardous parameters, but also some of the aesthetics values and parameters involved, you know. So those macam bau acceptability, if it's not it can't be acceptable by the general public, then it's not wholesome. When it's not wholesome, then we have to do something for that. For that reason is actually a need lah to do that. What you are talking about is more on apa ni, the standards. So that's actually more on the standards and the guidelines formulation at the national level, which is good that you raise it up, you know. But I think apa ni, Kemam team should answer this apa ni in more detail lah.
Doktor. Puan Hafizah. Kami terlibat dengan isu penutupan loji kerana bau. Pertama, the hazard is real, so because it has happened, and the risk is high lah. Dia anggap very high dari segi risk assessment. Tapi dari segi control measure pula, memang Kerajaan Selangor ada buat tindakan untuk. Dan ini telah di-announce lah dalam akhbar juga. Antara caranya nak mengelak, ini mengelak supaya tidak menutup operasi loji. Tapi mengawal bau tu satu hal lain lah. Surveillance dan sebagainya. Cuma kita ada kaedah untuk mengelak disruptive pollution begini dengan mengambil air ketika ia berlaku lah daripada kolam, takungan. Jadi ORS of River Storage tu adalah salah satu kaedah yang agak berkesan untuk mengelak daripada loji ditutup. Tapi mengelak pencemaran berlaku itu cerita lain dah. Itu control measure yang di punca tu saya ingat itu memang sukar selagi mana you know kita tidak ada surveillance tentang setiap industri yang berada di lapangan. Beribu ada dan semuanya berpotensi untuk mencemarkan. Dan dia boleh juga dimasukkan melalui apa sistem kumbahan. Yang berlaku pun ada yang dimasukkan melalui sistem kumbahan. Memang sukarlah. Cuma setakat mana kita ready untuk stop bila berlaku. Ataupun sebelum berlaku, susah. Tapi kalau berlaku, kalau dia melalui loji kumbahan, setakat mana loji kumbahan kita boleh stop the discharge into the river dan kawal yeah? Dalam sistem dia. Sama ada boleh atau tidaklah. Selain daripada itu ialah mengadakan sistem sumber alternatif ketika berlakunya pencemaran itu. Jadi bagi operator air, dia nakkan bekalan yang berterusan. Pencemaran tu berlaku tak berlaku, dia tetap boleh menjalankan operasi. Jadi kaedah menggunakan off river storage ataupun dipanggil apa baru ni, kolam tak ingat dari term baru yang digunakan oleh KASA taps takungan air pinggir sungai jadi itu boleh menyelesaikan buat sementara lah ya yeah? Itu saja.
Okay, thank you. Ada soalan lagi? Our comments?
Any more questions from the floor?
One thing, one question yang related to emerging pollutant tu macam EMR, macam bioplastik. Jadi apa kita punya current system ni ada consider that this new emerging parameter yang perlu kita monitor sebab sekarang ni banyak penyebaran berlaku kan. Raw water treatment jadi bypass this apa AMR atau bioplastik punya content yang boleh yang cannot be treated by conventional treatment. Boleh masuk dalam sistem bekalan air dan orang public minum.
AMR jadi, stands yeah. for antimicrobial
resistance. Yeah, bioplastic, that one. Jadi benda-benda macam tu, we kena a way forward. So our thinking ni not just depend on what current standard yang kita ada. Kita kena tengok the, what the emerging issue. Kalau mestinya should this pembekal pengalih monitor. Start monitor lah. Mungkin start merancang nak monitor AMR, bioplastic yang berlaku dalam air mentah yang tujuan untuk kita rawat. Jadi benda tu kita kena mula dah patutnya. Tapi I tengok tak ada pun inisiatif yang sistem yang dijalankan untuk monitor this emerging pollutant yang nyawa cakap globally discuss dekat peringkat WHO internationally, AMR, bioplastik, benda-benda kita kena start consider this apa pemantauan air mentah untuk tujuan rawatan untuk bekalan air. Jadi benda tu kita kena consider lah, ini pandangan saya lah. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess we can close the floor, the questions floor now. Boleh ke, doktor?
Boleh.
Okay, any last comments from you?
I think that's it. What we need to do is actually perhaps my presentation ni slides dia apa ni very compact, and then each might apa ni orang kata require explanation, especially to certain extent lah. But I think I hope everybody apa ni get the understanding of the whole scenario related to the risk-based approach that I'm trying to explain through this webinar. So yeah, some of the questions tu kalau ada apa ni kau tak jawab tu minta maaf banyak.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fiza. Before we end, can we have everyone cameras on so kita boleh tangkap gambar dulu for group photos?
Share first, stop share.
Apa, Mr. Lee?
Minta the doctor stop share.
Oh, okay. Doctor, right. Stop share.
Alright. Stop sharing.
Okay.
Alright. Thank you so much.
Page by page, yeah? Go.
Okay, boleh. Sekejap. Biar everyone buka dulu. Okay. Alright. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay, again. 1, 2, 3. Okay, ada lagi. Alright, another one please. 1, 2, 3.
Boleh peace ke?
Boleh, buatlah. Apa ni, kita punya presiden tak ada ya? Our MWA president. Kejap, sorry. Okay, another one, last one. 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you everyone. I guess I'll pass this to Mr. Lee to do the closing.
Okay, thank you everyone for your sustained support and stay on so long until the end. And I'm sure that you still have a lot of questions, a lot of things that you need to ask Dr. Hafiza, and I'm sure you can make some contact with her first, then we will see whether you can arrange for another session with her. To Dr. Hafiza, I just want to thank you on behalf of MWA. You have done an excellent job in clarifying so many things in regard to water quality and water safety plan. Something like what Haji Mansur has mentioned, there's something that we have put at the back burner, in the background, although it's so very important. And we hope that this session will raise awareness again for all the stakeholders, and that we will again see how we can take some further positive action to implement and put back this water safety plan in the forefront of our action plan. So for all the water operators and all the stakeholders, we just want to thank you that you will continue to support this good and noble effort to safeguard our water quality as well as our sustainable future for the water in Malaysia, and especially protecting the rivers and also the raw water. So thank you very much, everyone. So I hope you have a very good day, and keep safe and stay well. Okay, thank you.
Okay, all right. Thank you, everyone. Hope to see you guys for the next webinar. Thank you so much, Dr. Fiza.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you semua. Minta maaf banyak. Banyak yang apa?